on to item 5, tree reserve presentation. That is usually not what we've been doing at the presentation.
Thank you. that we've been thinking about for a period of time. We started many months ago in terms of conversations that we started to have with colleagues. And you may be aware that we have some good links with Cheshire West and Chester in terms of staff members and staff who previously worked in this authority who are now working in Cheshire West and Chester and have maintained those good links. And we decided that we would start to explore what this separate legal entity would look like and start and agreed a mandate with Cheshire West and Chester to start to do that work. And we began quite a comprehensive consultation and engagement process with a range of people, as you can see there, in terms of the schools, the governors, to test the waters in terms of what school support about this is an approach. And we've developed a programme team which has been together now for well over 6 months. We put together a bid which we were successful with in terms of an innovation approach, supported by DCRG, the LGA, and Solis. And that has meant that PwC have been working with us to help us develop a business plan because they've had experience in that in other parts of the country. Where that has led us to is the Cabinet report that you've mentioned, being conscious that went to Cabinet here on Rural last month, and it also went to the Cabinet in Cheshire West and Chester, which agreed the for us to move forward in the development of the next phase of the separate legal entity that we would need to set that up next year. Before I hand over to Julie, I will talk to you in more detail about what that separate legal entity company is made up of, what it contains, and what the government's arrangements are for it. We wanted to be very clear about what is it that we want in this company, this new arrangement to achieve, which I'm not going to go through all of those in detail, but as you can see clearly, putting children at the very heart of what we're trying to do in terms of improving attainment and achievement, enabling greater achievement for young people is what we're about. That high quality value for the services, the schools are confident in what they are buying, it's exactly what they need, and they're getting good value for money as well as that high quality service. That we create an entity that's commercially successful because it's in all our interest that will happen. And if we do this, it gives them the opportunity to enter more broader markets. We've already had interest from other areas in terms of the model we're thinking about and the services that we could potentially sell to other parts of the country locally. And what we also want to make sure that this authority, in entering this type of arrangement, and for Cheshire West and Chester, is going to be no worse off in terms of the arrangements that we wanted to put in place. So I'll hand over to Julie just to take you through some more detail.
I'm going on to the next slide. Can you see this? With difficulty. I'll explain it then. So this slide sets out what services are actually going into the company. That's this first column here. So we have services such as governor services, leadership and safeguarding, governor support, school development, swimming and educational visits, data support, PE, uniform like teachers, music, outdoor education, catering, cleaning and caretaking. So from Cheshire West and rural perspective, that's £22 million worth of services going directly to this separate legal entity. From a rural perspective, that's 157 staff, £7.5 million worth of services. Some of those are the EQ, education quality services, that are our current training services with schools that we operate in the council. But the bulk of the staff will be paid for cleaning and caretaking bracket. These are services that we feel without this kind of arrangement would be really vulnerable. So these are actually about protecting jobs for these people, perhaps even developing these services through the company. Community interest company, which is what it's going to be, was 50-50 shareholder with from ourselves and Cheshire West and Chester. The next column down the middle are what we call front door services. So these are services that schools will access through the front door of the separate legal entity. So they won't actually be directly actually run through the company, but as I say, element of run through camp the council or the services. Things like education, welfare, additional education or psychology time, human resources, occupational health, legal services, insurance, health and safety, minority ethnic achievement services, cash collection, not really them all, but there, that's the flavour of some of the services that could be bought through that front door. And those services amount to £7.5 million worth of turnover. And then the final column are buyback services, and these are services delivered through both Cheshire West and Royal Council that will be services to support the running of the company. So services such as human resources, finance, legal, procurement, IT, audit and performance and property. Now, these services, so that we don't get in a muddle with those authorities trying to provide these services to the single company, they will bundle them. So some services will be provided by Cheshire West and Manchester, some will be provided by Wirral, but these services will be bought back for 2 years. And then if that's working for the company, they will continue to buy them back. Okay. Move on to the next slide. This sets out the governance, the proposed governance for this new company. And just a little bit about, there was quite a lot of discussion with the work that Claire talked about with the PricewaterhouseCooper and the consultancy time, looking at what kind of a company should we have. Some consideration about whether it should be a charity, but the decision at the end of the day and recommendation was that a community interest company owned by both councils, where the profits were ploughed back into service delivery, was the best and most viable thing forward. And the cabinet report shows how we test out each of the different models. So in terms of the proposed governance structure, there'll be quite an influential shareholders group, and it's proposed that elected members from Wirral and Cheshire West and Chester, as well as a small number of senior officers, will sit on that group. And that is actually quite an influential group because they've been involved in hiring and firing the managing director, involved in overseeing the business plan, holding the company board to account for their delivery and oversight of the business plan, and oversight of the kind of performance framework for the whole company. The company board, I'll just get some names on that as well, we have the three executive directors from the community interest company, the managing director, the head of delivery, and the head of commercial management. So there is an injection of commercial operating into this company to make it outward-facing, looking at new authorities that might want to buy back these services, but also to make whatever services are delivered, keeping a strong authority ethos that they need to be commercially viable. The middle column sets out that you have couple of key people from Cheshire West and Chester and the Royal Council who are the key people who will be influencing the kinds of services in their dialogue with schools. So if I can explain, they'd be key heads of service within children's services in Cheshire West and Chester and Wirral who would know, for example, that there's a particular issue about white boys who are 7 to 10 who really need to up their game in terms of how we help them progress, I'm looking at it, in terms of maths and English. And so we want to work with schools to help them to raise the performance of particular groups of children, or perhaps, you know, narrow that gap in terms of children who receive free school meals and those who don't. So they would provide a bit of a client focus to the training company about how to raise the game and raise the outcomes for children across both rural authorities. The final box is non-executive directors. So they would be a head teacher or a governor from a rural school and a Cheshire West and Chester school, and a commercial representative. And that the company board. Different, for example, to some of the other companies. If you were setting up a social enterprise to deliver day services, for example, or some other aspects of social care, which would be council money to deliver the service. This is schools money, which is why elected members will be on the share of the not actually the company board, which is more an operational. So, next slide is the proposed company structure with the managing director, and then this just sets out how we'd be a head of commercial and a head of commercial management. The next few slides just run through some of the benefits for different stakeholders involved in receiving benefits from the community interest company. So, in terms of schools, their interest in developing this approach is in being able to deliver better outcomes for children. That is their primary interest. So high quality water on your services, increasingly improved value for money as the profits are ploughed back, schools are determining what kind of services they need to respond to children's needs, and a much more flexible approach to delivery. They'll, because of their engagement and representatives from their governors, from their teachers, they'll be able to actively shape the nature of this company. And the schools will spend less time sourcing services, being able to access them directly from the company or through that front door. And the company will have some ownership and involvement and interest in making sure that these are quality services that are accessed. Hopefully, things can be new and innovative, much more flexible, responsive to children's needs, and we can bring lessons from a wider range of schools, both in Cheshire and rural. In terms of local authorities, there have been some questions about whether the local authority will make a profit through doing this. And I think, as Claire explained, this is being set up on a no worse off principle. So, both local authorities currently receive some small amounts of money, Cheshire West and more than us, from the approach of training our current services with schools. And so, moving forward, there's a no worse off principle. So, neither authority loses money at the start of this new approach. But local authorities don't make money from this. But what we do is, through this, we see better services being around to be delivered to children in our schools. We see an improvement in the quality of services being delivered and value for money as we move forward, so making the schools money go much further. We see a growth in revenue and business from local authority services. So some of the buyback services, if they are effective and the company really values that support, then they want more of it going forward. Certain services access through the front door, they can increase. For example, if schools want additional educational psychology time, then we look at opening the both the core offer, we look at how we extend that to give the schools what they want. And so the final bullet point on this slide, it provides good support, more jobs in the local economy, as schools hopefully will want to buy back through this process. Any profits that are made through the company, the local authority, through the both local authorities, would want to work with the schools and the company to set up a very clear framework for looking at how that money was reinvested back into services for children. So that's another added bonus for taking this forward. In terms of the trading services, moving into this new company, so the £7.5 million was that we start off with, there's greater freedom to define and implement the ethos and the culture of the company, which are very much aligned to educational objectives. Being able to be developed to be much more customer focused, so not feeling that they're kind of hidebound by being part of a big local authority and bureaucracy. Being able to see that they can invest the surplus back into good education, and staff having a sense that that they're working in a thriving business, which is something that's growing and not being prone to kind of cuts and reducing over time. And final slide in terms of benefits, so the benefits of the collaboration between Cheshire West and Wirral. One example is we've got a brilliant outdoor pursuit centre in Oaklands. Cheshire West and Chester have got six outdoor pursuit centres. So there's a wider range of services, for example, just through that example of services going into the actual trade company. So schools could benefit from the range of the wider choice. And there's opportunity to actually share the experience across the two different local societies. And there's something about the company not being an extension of the local authority, it's something new, separate legal entity that sets up as a thriving business going forward. So my final slide is just to set out some of the next steps. As Claire said, we've got the green light, we're then going to our respective cabinets in November. So there's a set of actions that are now flowing. With the plan to incorporate the company from April 2015. It will be from a shell of the company, but there's still a lot of work to be done. There's a lot of detailed legal work, a lot of accountancy work that's taking place. But in terms of recruitment, we'll start with the recruitment of the managing director, so we'll start at the top, and that will be an external advert. The communication, there's been a lot of communication and engagement with staff. We've started having discussions trade unions, certainly talking with the schools, that consultation will continue, and a formal consultation moving forward with the staff and the trade unions who are directly affected. So consultation, collaboration and design, but at the moment it is very much business as usual.
Process behind them, you know, doing this. Thanks. when you were exploring this, did you look at other partnerships that were available, not just Cheshire West? I mean, we are part of the combined authority with the school system region. Wouldn't that be an approach that maybe would have been looked at? Or is it just Cheshire West that we decided to go with because some of our officers actually work for them?
We were mindful that Liverpool were actually starting off doing their own thing, and about a year ago we were looking at doing a much bigger joint piece of work in Cheshire West and Chester, and at the same time this had started, so this was a smaller piece of work under the aegis of the much bigger piece of work which didn't proceed. This piece of work, because and we have had a number of services where we've worked across Cheshire West and Chester, particularly with our schools. So we've got good relationships to build on. There's trust in terms of schools, some children can bring them to Cheshire West and Chester schools and vice versa. So there was already a fairly trusting relationship to build on. I think as Claire said in her introduction, the first part, there are a number of local authorities that may be interested in purchasing some of the services once the school is set up. The company set up. So it seemed about the right size, it seemed the logic to the partnership that we've developed with Cheshire West and Chester.
And Chair, just a supplementary question in that regarding the staff from Cheshire West and the local council transfer over to the arms of the company. The transfer over to the staff remain the same. You give them all of the ball and the services that are going to be traded. Would the staff follow over from the same staff and levels then for that?
The staff
and the wages and conditions?
The staff will transfer over on Tuesday on their current terms and conditions with trade union recognition. So the more detailed cabinet report talks about issues about different models of pension strategy, pension strain. One model was looking at the company picking it all up, the rules of local authorities picking it all up. I think the model that's been looked at there is the local authorities bear 80% of the cost and the new company 20%. So there's real detail being looked at now. And if any of the financial assumptions in the report want to be going off being on these issues about staff that we've not thought of so far, there's a caveat that we pull the communication cord, so to speak, and bring it back to our respective cabinets.
I mean, what is the timescale now for this maybe to happen?
Start from April, but it will be incremental from April. We need to get the managing director in place first. So I think people talk about having a shell of the company in place for
pay a living wage. And I'm assuming that competitors to the new company will not be in that position. So it will, particularly in those areas where there's a very high labour input, it will be difficult. And I also think, I'm also a little concerned, I think you should have that it was 2 years that the support services for the new company would come directly from the council. Now the new company may well find, and this perhaps, that that's a bit of a burden, a bit of an overhead that it will have difficulty living with. I just wonder, there are two particular problems, how significant you think they may be, and what again I think we can do about it.
Transfer over to the issue. Now, when that's happened in the past, I knew that the jobs should.
we're doing this because schools want to buy back services from local authority for Newcross, and that was also a part of the staff engagement program. So over time, it may not make sense that you have two sets of job descriptions for both. The company has its own job descriptions, but they would follow in line with the best HR practice from a local authority perspective.
Next, I noticed, as Councillor Hunt said, there's less staff and roles in departments. My concern would be where those roles are completed, because we need to have some reasonable staff in the Cheshire and transfer them to the central department. If that's the case in this chair, not that I don't have this chair, because it seems to be viable, probably isn't a few roles that's usual as well as staff.
I think the staff going into the company are staffing groups who, without this venture going forward, would actually be in very unusual jobs in those local authorities. They're going into the company with an assumption, based on all the modelling that's been done, that these are services that will grow and develop. So I can't foresee that we're in a position with kind of like a takeover by the judges and just the staff, or their staff being in more stable positions than the rural staff going into the
company. Okay, finally, just to clarify the word that you already decided, you thought, for example, two people doing identity jobs in both councils and similar services. The fact that Cheshire seems to give a new staff.
There's no inference that we are shedding any staff at all. We're going into this company on an equal basis in Cheshire West, and that's how we're all going.
So there's no job losses happening to this?
I can never guarantee that. What our aim is to make go into a company, to make it successful, to make it grow. We know we're going there on a very strong base, and that's the intention of the company.
Okay, speaking of the strong base, it's a common question. I did mention the password. How much interest have you gained? Does this offset or remain quite a large set of costs?
There has been fairly extensive engagement with head teachers, and the buyback through our current education quality service is really, really high. So that's a really solid base moving into the company forward.
The feedback that we've had from the engagement with schools, with governments, has been very positive in relation to their experience of working with, speaking about rural now, the experience that they've had of working with the school support services is positive, and therefore they see this as a positive move in terms of guaranteeing those services that they're used to receiving will be able to continue to be received, and there's potential opportunities to expand their choice in terms of the new entity.
I know talking with David Armstrong, who's done part of the work leading on this, his view is very strongly that some of the services like Metro, Catering and Cleveland are going to be in a much stronger position moving into this company than if we weren't moving forward with this venture. I'm talking about the services that would actually be directly in the separate legal entity, and they'd be able to become more flexible, more responsive to what the schools actually wanted, being without some of the kind of bureaucracy of a larger organisation, with the commercial influence from the very senior managers and from a commercial perspective, they'd be able to look at how they could be more flexible in what they provided to individual schools and more responsive.
Just to quickly mention that there is also one of the things that the new entity is very keen to do is to open markets for growth.
did also mention that you consulted with staff. So what forms did that consultation take? How are staff being in about this move? And that really does follow on to the second question. I noticed that many of the authorities that you talked about, the strategic director in particular in their presentation, chose a more mutual, sort of cooperative way of working where staff would take ownership or part ownership of the company. Why was that option not explored further here in Wirral, and it was just purely local authorities' ownership of the company 50-50?
Okay, I'll start with consultation. We have a really well-respected head teacher who's been part of the working group developing all of the proposals that went to our respective cabinets. I meet with governors on a termly basis, and certainly for the last three meetings we talked to governors about the proposals in detail. I meet with colleagues with the WASH, Rural Association of Secondary Head Teachers. Regularly on the agenda. I'm the primary head teacher plus the group around the special head teachers meetings. So, and also the schools forum, we've had discussions about this. So it's a bit of an iterative process. We're constantly talking to people with the key stakeholders. In terms of staff, there have been three newsletters now that have gone out to staff. We've had meetings with groups of staff about how this is developing. I meet with trade unions on a weekly basis, and we've had, certainly for the last few meetings, we've had discussions about this with the trade unions. There's not into the formal consultation yet, but briefing conversations with the trade unions. So, and there is also a very strong board that manages the current trading services in rural, WECS, Rural Education Quality Services. And that engages with primary and secondary head teachers. So they can see through that how their involvement and professional perspective on what schools need is actually influencing the shaping the curriculum packages of support that's available to schools. So it's building on that kind of model. The second question was about the nature of the company.
Thank you.
handling of the questions. The first one was about savings.
Yeah.
And clearly, most savings in the local authority are subject to reductions. Most services are subject to reductions. There's no planned savings in these services. The principle is that the local authority is no worse off, but that is just, that's it, no worse off. So they go in as is, and then the plan is and the projections are that they grow the services. In terms of training, to be honest, I'm not sure of the detail of that answer, so I'll look into it and come back to you, because I know that certainly the mandatory safeguarding training we want to be absolutely assured that every school receives that. So how that is proposed to be delivered in the future, I'll try and have a look back to you. I think we just need to clarify the time frame for the GP as well. So that's training the GP, and I'll come back to you.
Okay.
Thank you, Richard. I don't want to introduce discussion between sides, because I don't want to agree. But I do find it rather strange that apparently there are certain people who are going to take the question of the wisdom of the cabinet decision. I agree that this committee has got to look at things carefully. And should continue to do so. I think that the main thrust to support the cabinet decision is an excellent one, and I'm not going to cross the floor, so don't worry. But all I would say is that we need to keep a close watch on how this develops, because it is very, very important. And if people adopt that attitude towards it, then this committee can play an important part in promoting this.
Services that are currently provided through be included in statutory commissioner according to this model.
Is actually in the director of providing service. Yes. Thank you.
the time relying to a very large extent on what we were being told about people. In the last two or three weeks, I have had a sick life in the park, and I can say with all sincerity that the care, the medical attention, and all concerned is absolutely first class. I know that Arrow is having some problems at the present time, and doubtlessly that they are overcoming, but the attitude of the clinical staff, in particular, on Sunday, I met up with the consultant responsible for our particular discipline. And I said to him, I thought you chaps were always playing golf on Sundays. He said, we're so busy at the present moment, I couldn't possibly get my patients. And he really didn't mean it. Having said that, one final thing, because I spent a lot of time in the hospital as a result of this situation. And one evening, there was a shortage of three nurses on a particularly difficult group. And this was because the three nurses had not volunteered to turn up. Now, it wasn't that there weren't three nurses available, they just hadn't bothered to listen to them again. That was what I was told by the assistant in charge and one of the staff nurses. So it's not all of them, but there was a lot of it for them. And I'm very glad that I wish I hadn't seen them, because obviously the situation was domestically very trying and upsetting. But it was very good to see that what we have reported in the main is accurate, in my opinion.
All that said, I think, again, this plethora of agencies out there looking at the performance in the health area. But it doesn't mean to say that our role is good and an important role. The council does have an important role to fulfil. And we must look at just the basic, we're not asking to sort of reinvent the wheel, we just want to look at the same statistics that are available to others.
The outcome and the progress updates as part of the plan,
and the scrutiny recommendation could be identified in the objective column, and it has a particular recommendation number. The plan is broken down into six areas, which are listening to children and young people, supporting corporate parents in carrying out their responsibilities, actions to engage the rest of the council in corporate parenting, being healthy, staying safe, and enjoying and achieving an economic well-being. The plan runs until the 31st of March 2016, so it isn't complete yet, we're partway through. I hope you can see that we're making good progress against recommendations. If I just pull out some areas which we've been working on, the first one is that in September, the corporate banking group signed up to the promise, which has been refreshed by the Children in Care Council. And this is our promise to children in care, and includes things like providing a safe and stable home for children in care being treated as individuals, being treated the same as everybody else, so we've made some progress there, we promise. In terms of 19-year-olds who are in education, employment and training, we can see that there's some significant improvement in the numbers who are in education, employment or training as of March this year, which is 62%, compared to 37% 3 years earlier. We've also been part of the new belongings initiative, which is to improve outcomes for care leavers and raise awareness around care leavers. And as part of that project, we've improved supported accommodation for 16 and 17 year olds who have sent us homeless, and also for care leavers as well. We've also been working with an organisation called Empower, who does some analysis of the fostering service and to help us recruit and retain foster carers by using a far more targeted activity, using foster carers as part of our recruitment and assessment, and also developing our peer mentoring and support foster carers. We've also combined the personal education plan meetings and looked after children reviews, and we've also made progress with personal education plans by co-locating the looked after children education services workers and children's social work teams alongside social workers, and through that we're also improving in quality assurance and personal education plans as well. So if you have any questions, please, by all means, please ask them.
Thank you, Simon.
Brendan,
could you just tell us a little bit
help us to, and so far the feedback has
proposed that the government and the College of Social Work want us to adopt, so we adopted that approach. As I say, we've had some positive feedback so far, with a view to implementing the new framework in the new year.
Could I just add a couple of more things? I mean, Simon's mentioned the length with the professional capability framework. We are really, really focusing on what we're calling practice improvement across the whole of children and social care. And there's a weekly meeting, 1 o'clock every Friday, lunchtime, and all managers involved in children and social care are called to account for how they are improving. What we've done is we've done a number of things, such as during the summer we've audited over 200 children's cases, so we've looked at how we learn from the findings of those audits. We've worked with an ex-Ofsted inspector who has come in and looked at our front door, our central advice and duty team, and spent 2 days really analysing what was going on, doing an evidence-based report. And last month she came in and looked at some assessments that were undertaken by social workers and then met with the managers who signed off the assessments to say this was good, how you thought about, or you could think, I'm not sure about why you signed that off, so doing personal coaching to improve their practice. Another thing that we're doing is that we're in the middle of a consultation at the moment about reconfiguring our social work teams. And this is particularly pertinent to outcomes for children in care. Because the way we're currently structured, we've got assessment teams who do that initial assessment when children are referred to the council. And then behind that, we've got what's called care management teams in each locality. And those teams work with children in need, so vulnerable children, children who have experienced significant harm or are likely to, and are subject to a child protection plan. And children in care as a local authority. So these care management teams deal with all of that. And they do find that because the children on the child protection plan are living at home and vulnerable, and some children go to court for care proceedings, and that takes an enormous amount of time, and the judges are fairly demanding of social work in court, the looked after children are falling a bit by the wayside because they're safe. Homes where they're living and not so vulnerable and unstable generally. So the new model we're consulting on at the moment is that we have children in need teams in each locality, a number of smaller teams, and they work with children in need and children subject to a child protection plan. But in each locality there will be a dedicated social work team for children in care, so that they can try and get more stability, get those children's care plans progressed, if some of the children's plans are adoption, so they're not kind of stuck with nothing proactively happening to support them. So it's not a bad picture at the moment, but we think we can make it so much better. And this new proposal is based on talking with children, listening particularly to our Children in Care Council, saying how can we do this better through how we organise. That will make a really big difference. And we're constantly looking at how we improve the supervision that social workers receive from managers. And that part of that's about giving managers space and support themselves to enable social workers just to be a bit more reflective and not charging around reactive all the time. It's just really important to keep it safe.
Well, I'd like to focus on the way we managed to increase employment opportunities. When I was at university, the big area back then we said was social mobility and how people, the theory was people called progressive and meritocratic society, but I think it's been acknowledged widely now that it's come to be grinding halt. So I'm very, very impressed that we're managing to do this. I was wondering if you could just give me a few more details on how, and also, do we have any mechanism of following these young people up to see whether or not we've managed to create an avenue that they've succeeded in pursuing that into the world of employment or training?
Okay, I think it's really important to stress that we have a very good working relationship between the workforce. been a key driver behind the increase in the numbers of 19-year-olds who are education employment training. And in fact, at the recent New Belongings Conference, which I attended, Edward Timpson commented on the role and how we're doing that, which is really positive. And in terms of the tracking, all care leavers have a personal advisor. The personal advisor stays with that young person right the way through to 21 and up to 25 potentially young persons, so that person is still in education. So that personal advisor has a key role in supporting young person, the adults, in their life. There's a key document for the pathway plan which sets out the plan around that person's education, health care, accommodation, which is reviewed every 6 months. And the personal advisor supports the person right the way through. And that includes with employment training and education.
Thanks. Clarify something Simon said earlier regarding social worker remuneration. My understanding from previous meetings was that we had an issue with this in Rome. And from what you were saying we're now reasonably on par with other authorities. Does that mean we've actually increased remuneration levels for social workers? Or can you just expand on that?
We've done some research and looked at other local parts in the region. And in terms of the proposal, there is a proposal that social workers would have an increase in their pay. That is the proposal.
Just briefly to add to that, what the proposal involves is raising the starting salary of the newly qualified social workers. In Wirral, it's currently £22,500, so they would raise it up to about £26,000. And it would raise the top pay for experienced social workers.
Thanks for that report as well. That's good. Basically, I really like the idea of the takeover day, and I also noticed further on the report that another objective is to keep raise awareness and keep elected members and council staff aware of their corporate parenting responsibilities. So that is the sort of thing that I think would be a really great way of raising the profile to encourage. Not just chairs and deputy chairs, but all the new members like us, because I do have a background in working with that, using music as a tool to engage with people, with young people in care and young people who live in care. So I would really like to get them involved in that side of things. So I think that would be really nice to time. Cheers.
Can I just very briefly, just in terms of engagement and involvement, what we have this Thursday evening, the 4th of December, the looked after children awards evening. This is quite short notice, but if there are members who would like to attend and can attend, that is 5 o'clock Thursday tea time. So this week here, it's upstairs in the main room. And there's about 80 looked after children who are receiving awards. The small token and the certificate.
role models that are going to speak at the conference and sort of present and, you know, be the role models for the young people.
The award evening has been introduced by a young woman called Kim, who is a care leader herself, who sits on the corporate parenting group, and who is now an apprentice who works in the care leader team. So she's actually going to be introduced to you.
Right. What I would like to recommend is that you receive an update report to the conference client. You have to get that to the
end.
So we move on now to item 6.
New way in the future, focusing on how people can be supported. deferred payment schemes, so that we can also know when people have reached their new cap on how much they're expected to pay the lifetime of their care. And this altogether means an increase in demand and assessment potentially on the council and on our services and in terms of how we're going to support people and develop new ways of assessing people in the future. As well as that, we're safeguarding the green statute. The first bunch of those actually means a different way of working. It means a focus on well-being. We've just gone to the next slide. What it means is that we're shifting from what we can't do. So at the moment, if you are looking to access social services or indeed many of our health colleagues, you have to prove what you can't do. You have to tell us all things that you can't do in order to get services in terms of how ill or how things that you are unable to do in terms of ability or disability. Rather than a focus on what people can do, which is what we're trying to improve towards, and a focus on people's positive attributes and the potential be able to do things for themselves. And our starting point is about people's potential and their ability to do things for themselves, and we have a different approach to our assessment and a different approach to how we're going to be talking to people. So in terms of that, we're looking at a single holistic integrated assessment to consider the support people have available to them as opposed to this deficit approach that we're outlining, which would mean that we'll be looking at really what's available in terms of people's local communities, in terms of their voluntary sector, in terms of their families and in terms of what's available first before we get to the statutory sector and their involvement. This new approach will ensure people are supported only to meet their assessed needs in the most effective way. So, what is it that we can do from a health and social care perspective to deliver this? Well, that means less duplication, it means a single care plan and a single care coordinator through an integrated approach which we're developing through what we call integrated care coordination teams. Single assessment and single approach, focusing on people's attributes, is going to be the way that we're going to move things forward. In terms of when we do need to provide support, the focus will be very much on services that will promote people's independence and help to regain their independence. Things like assistive technology, self-directed support, so how people can actually put together their own support and also be able to sort of focus on independence there. Just in terms of the consultation process, we would call it consultation because formally we'd be using it to consult people, but what we're looking at here is much more of a production process. But we're sitting down with people such as the Old People's Parliament, Vision Forums, carers, and disability self-advocacy group, saying to them, what would this look like if we were going to be working with you in this way? We're talking about your potential to be able to be independent. How would that look in terms of our assessment and our ways of working? What were the questions that we'd be asking? How would that affect how we're going to support you? And working with them to develop this informed steering group based on key members from that. And they're going to be very much influenced by people that currently use services from other public services. So people that currently use services have to actually be reviewed. And we'll be asking those people through the review process. We're going to be doing this in a different way, what would it look like? So again, we'll be starting to get some information from them. We're very much at the beginning of this consultation process. So in terms of coming here and saying this is what it would look like, we're unable to do that. It will depend very much on what you services are going to tell us about that and how it's going to move forward. And in terms of how it will affect partner agencies in this integrated approach, so in the community trust, tissue partnership, the hospital and other partners, how's that going to affect their ways of working? And that's something again we're talking to them and saying, this is our way, this is what we're going to be doing, and how are we going to shape up this new culture. The same message should be heard whether you are in a hospital bed or whether you are in a community being supported by social services. So we need to obviously be clear about how we're going to move forward with that. So in terms of the last slide, the three areas that we envisage that we need to be working on in the brief effectively are very much around changes to our assessment and support planning processes, so the questions that we're going to be asking people, but then also the way that we support them in the future. Change. And we'll be developing that with our people that put together our systems and support us and the different logic system which our social services now has. But we'll also be looking at how we're going to change our workforce and the culture. We won't just be doing that within our social services,
very kind comments where it's been talked about for a long while, and there's an opportunity to have cooperation between the NHS and the meeting will be held in Liverpool on the 4th of December.
council stressed the necessity to promote the coordination and cooperation between health watch, health and wellbeing boards, and local exclusion committees. Further work needs to be done on this. The meeting has been arranged and fixed. Health Watch,